Today on 3rd of November 2011, Swami has blessed us with the visit of Professor Anil Kumar and Auntie Vijaya, and not forgetting Brother Mahendran from Malaysia, the Deputy President from Satya Sai Organization Malaysia. So it's a real privilege. As most of you know, Uncle and Auntie has been given a mission by Swami, starting just after Deepavali with a trip to Zone 4. And he has visited Malaysia, going down from Langkawi, Penang, KL, Johor Bahru, Singapore, and now today in Brunei. And large crowds have attended his talks in Malaysia. And it's like Swami visiting us in Brunei. It's answering our prayers, our long-standing prayers that Swami will visit us. And Swami has come in the form of Brother Professor Anil Kumar and Sister Vijaya. So, what's a blessing for us? Sai Dovuto is aware of Uncle and Auntie's closeness to Swami, but it's my duty to give some background of Professor. First of all, a little background history. Professor is from Guntur district, Andhra Pradesh. He was an undergraduate of Andhra Pradesh Christian College, Guntur. Postgraduate in MSc in Biosciences. He's a lecturer in Botany. He's a principal at Brindavan Campus, 1989 to 1995. Professor of Biosciences at Prashanthi Nilayam Campus, 1995 till date. State President, Satya Sai Organization, 1985 to 1989. He's written 26 books. Very important, all Sai publications. And his most important qualification is his Swami's interpreter to Swami's discourses since 1989. That itself is a real challenge. You know, Swami is a perfectionist, needs exact translation and fast, and sometimes difficult to translate. I've seen many times when Swami gives a poem, we are lost at words to translate fast. And many times it is impromptu. And he has been also called to give talks impromptu. Just suddenly Swami says, "Professor Anil Kumar, give a talk." And so much so, I've seen in one of Professor Anil Kumar's interview, I've read it, that he says he doesn't prepare his speech anymore, because he says he has let it Swami to talk through him. It's like the flute, Krishna's flute. Swami talks through him. So he comes ready every time, but he is the flute, and Swami speaks through him. We all have to have prepared texts like this to read. Okay. Once in an interview, Professor Anil explains his first visit to 1970 to Puttaparthi. He was completely ignored, it seems, for all 5 days. But his prayers for his wife's health was answered. I'm sure Professor Anil Kumar will elaborate on that. He was first in elocution and debating contests, still is. But the interesting thing is, we all think is so, for 8 long years, in spite of multiple visits to Swami, he was ignored. It was a real test. And Professor Anil Kumar came out with flying colors. Because then suddenly Swami calls him one day by name, and he was surprised, and asked about his wife. That's interesting. That is Swami, testing and all-knowing, but pretending to ignore. Then suddenly things start changing. He was asked to translate, then give talks. Then he was very busy. He passed his test with flying colors. He has a lot of close experiences with Swami, and you can spend hours listening to him. We were listening to him, and I think we didn't have time because we wanted to give him some rest. But I'm sure all of you are eager to hear his experiences. We can listen and listen and listen. We won't get tired of Swami's experiences. Anyway, today's topic is core ethical and moral values in daily life. There has been a deterioration in values this generation. What has caused it? There's no clear black and white now. Everything's gray. In many cases, white has become black and black has become white. So we don't know which is which. Auntie Vijaya, not forgetting, has been a strong pillar for professor's present status. She is a good speaker by herself. We didn't give her a chance, I'm sure. She will have a lot more experiences also. She hears Swamis in her dreams and so many interesting experiences. We would like to call upon Professor to give us some guidance in the above topic and guide us through this difficult situation in life. And most important of all, we'll reserve questions in the end. Some of you might have written questions, which we'll try to collect and give it at the end. And Professor will try to answer some of these questions. And in the process, give us all some enlightenment. And thank you. I'm sure you didn't come here to listen to me. Professor is eager to this. Thank you.
Sai Ram. We pronounce at the lotus feet of our most beloved Bhagavan, dear brothers and sisters from Sai family. I'm extremely happy to be here this evening for two reasons. I heard the name of this country while I was doing my 11th class in social studies, Brunei. Thereafter, nobody spoke about this to me all these years. So when I heard this Brunei, I thought I should see that. I should know that. That made me drawn to this place. The second reason is I was told that we have a very small family of Sai devotees here. I sincerely believe numbers don't matter in spiritual field. You will never find in our history, in our mythology, in our spiritual texts, any guru addressing thousands of gatherings. Gathering attended by thousands of people is more meant for political purpose. We are not political people. It's not the number that counts. But however, where there are number of devotees, they naturally come. When there are less, it does not mean I can treat you less than others. Number may be less, but you are nowhere less than others. And please believe me, I am not given to flattery, for which I had to pay heavily in life. I don't praise people unless I feel they are deserving. When once they are deserving, nobody can prevent me from praising them. So, please believe me when I say the bhajan standards, I am sure Vijayalakshmi also would agree with me when I say bhajan standard Brunei, wah, top, top, top. Very, very, very nice. What a melody it is. What profundity it has. What depth of devotion, fathomless, it takes you to. It is really Swami's benign grace. Apart from that, I have taken upon myself, nobody delegated me, to meet as many devotees as possible, particularly now, when we are missing Swami physically. But it is not a compliment again, it is a fact. as I see you singing, as I see the discipline and perfect silence abiding, not even a whisper, you don't miss Swami. Because you feel Swami within you. You are feeling Swami within you. Or else it's impossible to sing that way. I'll begin my talk invoking Bhagavan's blessings on each and every one of you and your families. With a note of selfishness that he should bless me with another visit to Brunei. I am really excited to find the greenery around, cleanliness in particular. If cleanliness is godliness, I have to declare Brunei is next to godliness in its cleanliness. In spite of vehicles, automobiles dashing their way, the silence all over cannot be taken this way that less population, therefore less noise. No, no, no. Two people can make more noise. Yes. You find in families only two or three staying, but the whole street can listen to their fight. So silence cannot be credited to less population, no. As I observe, the silence seems to be the discipline of the place. Most convenient to lead a spiritual life, because it is only in silence the depth of God, the voice of God is heard. Therefore, when I came to know that Dr. Babu has been here for the last 19 years, nothing strange about it. You'll be here for 90 years more. I really appreciate your time and your interest for being here this evening. I'm also aware of the constraints of time, and so I have to be bound by the time frame given to me, though I may excel a little bit, which has become more or less a habitual thing. And since this is an occasion to declare openly my gratitude, my heartfelt thanks, my sincere compliments, together with congratulations to Brother Mahendran Armugam, who worked tirelessly for the last 2 months, or even more, 3 months. Because to make all these arrangements such that I will be visiting 5 countries is not an easy thing, contacting people. I'm also a little bit organizer, so I know what it is. I really pray Godspeed in all his efforts and endeavors in the years to come. May Bhagavan shower his choicest blessings on Mahendran and his family. Thank you very much. And the voluminous file, he passed on to me one paper, day-to-day activity, second paper, flights, numbers, arrivals, dates, 3 accommodation numbers, 4 the topics and all that, number of tickets again. He should have been in the planning commission in the government of Malaysia. Perhaps what a loss to the government of Malaysia is a gain to such an organization in Malaysia. Yes, it's a gain. And now, I cannot speak anything I like, because you have given the topic too, along with the time frame. But I'm a teacher, I know how to go between. The ethical and moral values in daily life. What is ethics? What are morals? Are ethics and morals the same? If they are same, why should there be two words? You can say just morals. Why ethics? You can say simply ethics. Why morals? There are two words, vocabulary, nomenclature, because each word has its own importance. Something special to convey. As I look at it, ethics is applied to a community, a society, a generation of people. That's what ethics is. Societal, social oriented, community centered. While morals, individual code of conduct, individual behavior, individual attitude, individual relationships, individual personality, individual individuality, that constitutes morals. Then, morals are taken care of, ethics are ensured, ethics guaranteed. You cannot have ethics without morals. You cannot have second floor without the first floor. If you attempt it, please do it tomorrow and let me know. So first floor, then second floor. Morals and ethics. Now, Baba has put it in three words. All morals, all ethics. He has put it in three words. Sachi Sai Baba, though he does not like me to call him like that, which he openly said, I am wrong. But yet I am tempted to call him like that, again and again. He is latest God, latest avatar of computer, electronic, space age. Who can sum up all values and ethics into three words? Tell me. Which iPod or iPad? Anything can sum up. iPhones? People have their own language. Someone was telling me. TOTPOP. They have got their own meanings. So, no phone, no connection, no communication could ever convey like Bhagavan, because he belongs to this atomic age. He belongs to this space age. He appeals to the modern generation. That's why Bhagavan Sri Sat Sai Baba is so popular all over the world. If he goes on drawing illustrations, examples from the past, archaic, outdated, stone age, cow dung era, nobody would listen to him. Baba, you are God, be comfortable to yourself. But he is not like that. He speaks on electronics. He speaks on laser sciences. He speaks on cardiology. He speaks on neurology. He speaks of engineering. He speaks of the art of cooking. He also speaks of the quality and the color of saris to be worn by women. Yeah. So Baba is latest because down to earth. He is so close to everybody. To everybody we can talk. And his discourses apply to every person, not to selected people. We have got some saints and some gurus whose talks are meant for enlightened so-called intellectuals, though they are not. Those that call themselves intellectuals are not at all intellectuals. No intellectual would ever call himself, "I am an intellectual," unless he's a stupid. So, Baba's talks appeals to everybody, from tiny tot to an youngster to middle-aged, retired, literate, illiterate, boy or a grandfather, a rural, a rustic to metropolis city, professionals are masters of science, are masters of humanities, whatever may be. Everybody, please think of this point, which you do not find anywhere. If my talk is appealing to graduates, children will get bored. If my talk is interesting to children, others will go on looking at the watches. Here is Baba, whose talks are interesting to children too, a grandmother who is ready to go on bon voyage to the next planet. She too appreciates him. A great scholar appreciates him. An uneducated, illiterate, unlettered individual also begins to appreciate him. In the same discourse, no talk 6 o'clock PhDs, 7 o'clock MSCs, 8 o'clock rural people, because they can sleep also. It is not that. In the same congregation, at the same time, there is only one man, there is only one divine personality who would be able to impress everybody on the same topic. That is Bhagavan Sri Satya Sai Baba. Only. Because scholars say, "We have not heard that interpretation till now." Children say, "Stories are very interesting." Musicians say, "Arre, what a melody in his voice it is." And women discover, "Baba knows about cooking more than I know." So Baba is ultimate in every aspect of human life, be that mundane or spiritual, be that momentary or eternal, be that phenomenal or ephemeral, be that worldly or otherworldly. He is ultimate. Therefore, on this topic, no surprise if I say that he mentioned only 3 words, which covers all ethics, all morals. See that? That is greatness of Baba. First, what does he say? Daiva Preeti. Daiva Preeti. Love for God. You should love him. Love for God. Intense love. Daiva, God. Preeti, love. Love for God. Daiva Preeti. If you love God, what happens? Papa Bhiti. Fear of sin. Papa Bhiti. Fear of sin. Okay? And then what? Sanghaniti. Morality in society. 3 steps. So, Sanghaniti, ethics, based on morality, what we call Papa Bhiti, and that's again based on Daiva Preeti, love for God. Connecting morals and ethics, there's Daiva Preeti as the foundation or as the basis or as a connecting link. People go on saying, do that, nobody will ever do that, including the speaker. But when you love God, you'll do it. I was watching from the hotel where I was accommodated. There I saw rain there. I expected that I would be talking to doctors, both couple here. However, Mahendran, who followed me, that's all. I never expected you. You are here in spite of the rain. Not because the charisma of Anil Kumar. I'm not a fool yet. And I'm not a film actor. No, it's too late also. Even if I want to try. And I'm not any dignitary, which I am not, nor any desire either. Then what made you come here? Because of the love of God, Daiva Preeti, you already have. This Daiva Preeti, love of God, love for God, whatever may be, establishes, will never allow you to commit a sin. Papa Bhiti, it will never allow you. Because you have got Daiva Preeti, you love him. You will have that Papa Bhiti, fear of sin. How Papa will feel about it? How Papa will take it? What will see? How can I face him? How do I talk to him? These thoughts will arise, Papa Bhiti. These two are necessary that lead to Sanghaniti, morality in society. Now, coming to ethics, as I said, applicable to the community, societal or social ethics, norms of the community, are the five basic values. Satya, Dharma, Shanti, Prema, Ahimsa. The five basic values constitute ethics. Why? They are eternal. Satya, truth of India is not different from Satya of Brunei. Satya of Indonesia is same as Satya of Malaysia. Satya 10 years ago is same today, truth also. So, these basic fundamental, primordial principles of life that constitute ethics are Satya, Dharma, Shanti, Prema, Ahimsa. Truth, righteousness, love, peace, and nonviolence. Fine. So, that is the mansion, and that's the beauty of it. That is the lighthouse that they decide the standard and the culture of the nation. The culture of the nation depends upon its ethics or the five values. Whereas morality may be changing depending upon the society. At one time, please believe me, in India, to go abroad is a sin. You know that? To go abroad is a sin. In India, at one time. Today, not to go, worst of the sins. Is worst of the sins. At one time, a girl should get married at the age of 8. Today, if anyone performs, both of them will be behind the bars. So, what are morals? Morals are norms of the society, the behavior of the community, the civilization. Morals constitute civilization. Ethics constitute culture. Culture and civilization are different. The culture of a nation, the culture of the family, the culture of a community, they are eternal, everlasting. Morals differ from place to place. Morals differ from place to place, yes. What is right in India is not right here. What is right here is not right there. If you go to villages, ladies, with these pants like that, all people will be staring at you. And if you wear saris here and go to work, and then the sari under your feet, you'll be nicely dismissed next morning. So, you cannot standardize, make parameters so far as morals are concerned. They're different. But ethics are eternal. Changing values are the eternal values in changing society. Eternal values in a changing society. Eternal values are ethics, changing society, morals. Am I clear?
Yeah.
Now, morality, as you believe in, as you are brought up, as you are trained, as you are placed at a particular living, profession, whatever may be, demands some kind of discipline. To go late is not tolerated in certain places. If you are punctual, you are very funny in certain places. Late coming is a usual practice. So, the point is, this morality, whatever we believe in, constitutes the very personality of an individual. He dresses well. He doesn't come in an awful way. He's a formal man. He comes in pukka perfect dress, befitting the occasion. And he articulates well. He has got all the manners, etiquette, decency. He observes all those that are essential, expected of a gentleman. That is moral. That is morals. Now, coming to the morals, what I say, civilization, they go on changing. Simple example. In India, when teacher comes, students get up. And when teacher comes there, yes, be seated. Then they sit, the teacher sits. But in certain places, nobody get up. Why should I get up when you come? It was a shock to me, not to mention the name of the country, because I don't want to have any ill will towards anybody. It is their way of life. Who am I to comment? It is their way of life. They may say, why should you get up when he comes after all? So that's again different. Therefore, morals, the daily conduct, the daily behavior, what we believe in, they go on changing. Look at our families. I think it must be, you may be, oh, you're for too young, you say. People of my generation, I don't want to tell my age anyway, of our generation, of our age group, we never say no to our parents. We dare not say no. What's wrong with you? That's all. We cannot talk in front of them. Right. When elders are talking, why should you hear? Go back. You see, the lady sitting there is Vijayalakshmi. She hails from same place. We belong to same place. But please believe me, I saw her only on the wedding day. And what happened was, discussions were going on. What will happen? What is their family? What is your family? And where to celebrate? When to celebrate? Nobody bothered to ask me. I had to speak to my younger brother. And I tell mother that I want to see the girl, whether I can marry her. And younger brother slowly told my mother, he wants to see the girl before him. Shut up. What does he know? Shut up. What does he know? I have seen. Can he see better than me? Ask him to shut up. That was the generation. Not only me, all of us of that generation. Then came next generation. Daddy, shall I do that? First generation, do it. Next generation, shall I do it? Okay. Don't do that. Okay. That a kind of dialogue. It was monologue that led to dialogue. And today, all right, don't go there. Why? Why? All right, stay back at home. Why? And Anil Kumar will be coming today. So what? All right, I appreciate if you wear this color. Nice suit there. No, Daddy, I have another color. Now confrontation. Monologue, dialogue, confrontation. I don't blame them. Winds of change. You are not exception. It is a global change. It is a universal change. A child plays on the computer. Well, I cannot. 6-year-old child, tap, he does it. I asked my grandson to teach me a PowerPoint. What are you telling? But he was so fast because he's brought up in America. I said, hey, useless fellow, be slow. Slow. Let me note down points, one first point. Then I'll do it. Ta-ta-ta! It's boring to teach you, understand? I'll do what you want, that's all. How many slides you want, I'll do it. No, I don't want to teach this. Then I told him, are you useless? I taught for 45 years. If I'm impatient for like you, how could I be a successful teacher all along? Generation has changed. Children are very intelligent. They are very critical. They are very sharp. It is at this stage Satya Sai Baba appeared in our midst. Satya Sai Baba appeared in our midst as avatar. Has not this avatar been not there, the younger generation would have been completely spoiled. Completely spoiled. I do not know your experience. God has blessed me to go around about 25 countries or so. I am not giving the cricket score either. Not interested. A rolling ball gathered for mass. It's not that. In certain places, particularly abroad, say United States, say UK, Canada, all youth that are from Balavikas, that are in Sevadal, they are million times better than others who are not put to this kind of training. There's a marked difference between the children of Satya Sai fold and the children who are not within the Sai fold. What is greatest contribution of Satya Sai Baba? The greatest contribution of Satya Sai Baba is more to the countries outside India. Outside India. How do you expect Japanese to recite Veda for 1 hour? Can you dream Iranians, Iraq people reciting Veda, Chinese hours? How is it possible? It is Satya Sai Baba. Youth taking to service. How do you account for that? Therefore, my friends, at this time, we parents are helpless. We cannot tell children. They'll say, what do you know? I asked my son to study mechanical engineering long ago. He said, what do you know of mechanical engineering? Why do you want to say? Then I said, in our younger days, only 4 branches. Civil engineering, mechanical engineering, electrical engineering. Therefore, I said it. He said, there are 40 branches now. You were born at a time when there were only 4 branches. Today, there are 40. Well, why do you want me to study mechanical engineering? First time I understood what generation gap meant. First time I understood that children know more of these times, of the present, than all of us. So I don't blame them. We can't command them. We can't dictate them. They don't follow you. And in between, the morals will be at stake. Ethics will be shaken to the bottom. At this time, Satya Sai Baba, the divine parent, appeared in our midst. Now I go to the other aspect. How to know ethics? How to know morals? From the life of Bhagwan. From the life of Bhagwan, you can know what they are. Such that you can practice. Let me speak of ethics few points. Satya, truth. Satya at the physical level, Satya at the spiritual level. I'll speak of Satya at the spiritual level a moment after. Even at the physical level, Satya is truth. Worldly level. Promise made should never be taken back. Word said should never be withdrawn. Project undertaken cannot be cancelled. Meeting arranged cannot be cancelled. Promise given. When once you say, you should hold on to that, cling on to that, come what may. Bhagavan Sri Satya Baba is of that type. When he started college there at Anantapur 40 years ago, he announced publicly there will be college at Anantapur. Swami said it and later walked into the dining room. And trust members were sitting there. One trust member said, Swami, how can you start college next year? Baba immediately said, it is my problem, not your problem. Then that man said, Swami, excuse me. Why I ask you is this. There's no money in the trust. 40 years ago, no money. College requires at least 50 lakhs those days. How to do that, Swami? There's no money. Right. Don't have your BP unnecessarily shot up. Blood pressure. Don't worry. You just calm down, take rest. Swami will take care of it. Believe me, my friends, I'm speaking in the august divine presence of Bhagwan. Next day, within 24 hours, 1 crore is deposited into the account of Satya Sai Central Trust. 1 crore. Then Swami calls that trust man. What do you say? Then Swami says, it will happen. It cannot go back. That's what truth is. Truth is unshakable. Truth has no fear. Truth has no hesitation. Truth cannot be doubted. Truth has no hesitation, doubt, ambiguity, nothing like that. Truth is truth, straight, that's all. That's what Satya Sai Baba. His name itself is Satya, the truth. Aham Satya Bodhakaha. I'm the propagator. I'm an emancipator of the principle of truth, as Baba himself declared. Satya. As I have to cover the other gamut of the topics, I have many more things to say on truth, because we can speak on truth for one full week without having to speak and make you speak anyway. So, leaving truth at that stage, we go to the next. Dharma. Dharma is a word that has several meanings. Some people think dharma meant charity, giving money, donation, feeding people. Correct. Dharma has another meaning. As a celibate, as a college student, unmarried, you have got some discipline of life. That's called brahmacharya, celibacy. As a married man, you have got certain responsibilities, certain principles to follow. That's called grihastha, householder. Then come third stage. You have to train your children, pass on your duties slowly. Watch how they are doing. Guide them as they do. Help them when they want. Slowly you are retiring. That's called vanaprastha, recluse. Then comes final stage. You are not bothered about anybody. Your son comes, says, Daddy, what shall I do about business? Do what you want to. Daddy, shall I be here in Brunei or United States? Wherever you are happy. Because this is what sannyasa is. Renunciant detachment. This is dharma. This is dharma. As a bachelor, celibate, I cannot have married life. Something wrong with the fellow. He must be whipped, if possible, hanged also. A grihastha cannot be a celibate. Something medically are wrong with him. And they cannot continue their life unendingly. What? You are a big bore. Why? In certain families, father goes on dictating things to a grown-up boy with 40 years. He has got his children. He tells me, go out now, don't go out now. What is all this? It's so horrible, ridiculous to look at. So, we do that. Yes, earn well. Distribute to your children. Make them fit enough to live. Thereafter, hurry home, recluse, retire. Advice, that's all. And then, sannyasa, you live for yourself. What am I? Who am I? Where am I? Why am I born? What is this family? Where will I go? I have to leave this family one day or other. Where am I going? Where from have I come? What is had in between? These things should be centers of discussion of a sannyasi, renunciant. It cannot be expected of a householder. If a householder goes on thinking, what is family, what children? Right, behave yourself properly. Then father-in-law will take charge of this fellow. Because he is guilty of getting his daughter married to such a useless creature. This is dharma. That's why Swami tells everybody. Some ladies come there. Swami, we want to be here, we want to be here. Shut up. Go home and serve your husband. Go home and take care of your children. Yes. And there are some people who say that, Swami, I want service, I want... You have enough of service at home. Take care of your children, take care of your husband. That is service. Not taking a broomstick cleaning the streets. That is public service. Those that do public service, they do disservice privately. They have four sweepers at home while they sweep the street. I don't know, it's not that. So, dharma is the one's own duty. Once I'm a lecturer, I'm supposed to teach. If I go on singing and dancing in the classroom, it's not my dharma. No. So, doing your duty is dharma. Observing the phase of your life is dharma. Vyakti dharma, individual duty. Samishti dharma, the duty of a community. That is all dharma. Many more things can be said about it. I'll give one example. Many people came and said, Baba, thank you, Swami. You have spent a lot of money for us. You have spent about 700 crores, Bhagavan, to provide us drinking water. We have come here to thank you, said people. Do you know what he said? It is my duty, sir. You don't thank me. It is my duty. Do you thank your father? Oh, father, you are great. You are wonderful. So you have given me new pant. What is shanti? The peace. People, I'm just joking. With no ill will. We had one Balavikas teacher, a senior lady, well informed, highly resourceful, a scholar on the subject human values. As she was speaking on human values, she went on, I was the state president at the time. You know what peace is? What is peace? What is peace? Peace means, oh ho. At the end of the talk, I said, madam, you have no peace, first of all. And you are speaking on peace. Subject is good. But there's not even peace of peace in what you said. So peace is not said. Peace is not spoken. Peace is not an expression. Peace is an experience. Peace is an experience. You cannot say, I am very peaceful. Let doctor record your blood pressure. I am peaceful. Politicians are good at it. High BP, but peace. So it's not like that. It's plastic, synthetic, chemical peace, but natural, not natural peace. So peace is an experience. How do you say that? Bhagavan gives one example. While Bhagavan Buddha was passing by, Bhagavan Buddha, many young fellows gathered around him, started heckling at him. Prince, prince, with a shaven head, wearing ochre robes, walking along the street with a begging bowl, without footwear, a prince married to young fellows, Buddha looked like a fool. They all started calling him names, making fun of him. And Buddha was like that, simply with a smile. After some time, Buddha said, is it complete now? Is your gas exhausted? Yes. Have you all spoken well? Okay. Right. Be happy. I'll be going to the next village. Those local villagers will come there to receive me. If they hear you like this, they may beat you. I feel hurt. I am happy because you are happy. By criticizing me, you are happy. Good, I am happy. The other way, those villagers are happy by praising me. I am happy. I am happy towards both the people. Either praise or blame. That is peace. Peace is that which cannot be disturbed. We lose our peace when the first cup of coffee is delayed. We lose our peace when payment of annual increment is delayed a couple of days. We lose our peace when we don't get our promotion. We lose our peace when we are not given VIP treatment. That is not peace. That is ego. Ego. Oh, I'm peaceful. Why not? You are given all VIP treatment and you are tough fellow, you are peaceful. No. It's ego satisfaction. Whether success or failure, people may praise you or blame you. If you don't lose your calm, if you don't lose your composure, that is called peace. Bhagavan, Sri Satsai Baba, is an embodiment of peace.
Papa.